Amen. It's good to be in the house of God, isn't it? Amen. It's good to be together again as brothers and sisters in Christ and be able to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Amen. We're glad that you're here in our service this morning. I'm glad to see you today. Some of you I've missed. I haven't seen you for a week or so, but you're here today, and we say God bless you for being here this morning in the presence of the Lord. Amen. If you're here for the first time, we just want to acknowledge the fact, amen, that you've been sent to the Lord by being here today, and you're a blessing to us. May God bless you for being in our service this morning here at Harvest Fellowship. That word that Greg delivered from the Lord was right on. Amen. I just want you to know, man of God, that was a word for the house. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And I want everybody else in the church to know, amen, that I haven't spoken to him, amen, other than to let him know that he had liberty to speak in the house as a prophet of the Lord, amen, in the house. And he revealed some things to us today, amen, from the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. And I can validate, amen, that it was from the Lord today, because I've had people tell me, amen, there's upheaval and there's things going on. Some people feeling like if God is sending them out, and they feel like they need to leave. And so that was a good word, and it refreshed my soul. Amen. Because we need to hear the voice of God. Let me try that over here. We need to hear the voice of God. Somebody needs to know today that God speaks from heaven. We have His written word, and we go to the Bible, and we get the security of the balance in our life and the truth of our life from His written word. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. But there is a prophet in the house, and there's a gift of prophecy in the house, and there's release that comes as fresh manna into the house that gives us a rhema word, a right now word, praise the Lord. And the word has been released into the house today, as released to refresh us and bless us and strengthen us and encourage us. Do I have somebody in the house today that needs to be strengthened and encouraged? Amen. God does that to bless you, to strengthen you, and let you know that it's going to be all right. That God watches over you. He knows, amen, this morning. He knows today what your struggle is. He knows how you feel this morning. And it's okay, because God is in control. All right, I see this is going to be a real lively bunch this morning. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. Would you just lift your hands with me this morning? Father, we do thank you today, God, for all that you have done. We are truly amazed this morning. We are amazed in you. That, Lord God, you have truly, Lord God, kept us. Lord, you've called us and saved us, filled us with your precious Holy Spirit, and you've kept us. Lord, you are faithful. And God, I just pray you confirm that word in the lives and hearts of every soul that's in this place. The Lord, by the power of your Spirit, Lord God, and answer, Lord God, to the declaration of your word, Lord God, that you will supply every need in the house. That we will leave this place different than we came. That we will be encouraged and strengthened and blessed and lifted up. That, Lord God, we will acknowledge today you in all of our ways. You will direct our path. You will make a way, even where there seems to be no way. And we give you praise in the name of Jesus. And the church said, amen. Praise the Lord. All right, would you open your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11, the first of the four Gospels. Amen. We're going to go to chapter 11, and we're going to begin reading in verse 11, and we're going to read down to verse 19. Matter of fact, I think I want to back up a little bit. Amen. Would that be okay if I just back up a little bit more? Amen. We're going to go all the way back to the first verse, give you a little bit of context this morning. Amen. That shouldn't upset you too much. Amen. It's not a whole lot of reading this morning. Maybe a few more verses than you're used to, but we want to get the context here of what God is trying to say to the church. Amen. We live in a day and time where we have to have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Hallelujah. So let's look at Matthew 11, beginning in verse 1. It says that it came to pass when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed from there to teach and preach in their cities. Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said unto him, Are you who was supposed to come, or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said unto them, you go and tell John again those things which you have heard and seen. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached unto them. And blessed is he whosoever it is that shall not be offended in me. And as they departed, Jesus began to say to the multitudes concerning John, what did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken in the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in safe raiment. Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, and more than a prophet. For this is he, of whom it was written, behold, I will send my messenger before your face, which shall prepare your way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen the greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Praise the Lord. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if you can receive it, this is Elias, which was for to come. He that has ears, let him hear. But where shall I like this generation? Or who, or what time shall I like unto this present generation? It is like children sitting in the market calling to their fellows, saying, we have piped unto you and you have not danced. We have mourned unto you and you have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and you say, behold, a gluttonous man and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified by her children. I want to go back just a few verses here to verse 11 and 12 and read my text this morning, get into a thought today about advancing the kingdom of God. We'll talk to you for a little while. There's something stirring in my soul about the kingdom of God that I want to present to you today. And I need the Lord's help. But let's read verse 11 and 12 again. And it says, verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there has not risen a greater prophet, that's what he was talking about there, than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. I want you to catch that phrase. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist. Verse 12. And from the days of John the Baptist until now. Say now.
Now.
From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. It's from that 12th verse I'm going to preach to you this morning, the thought of advancing the kingdom. Would you bow your heads with me again? Father, we thank you, God, as we sit, put this service into your hands. Lord God, Holy Spirit, bring to my remembrance, Lord, those things that you want me to say. Lord, anoint me, God. Let the fire of God fall, Lord God, and let it be released over your people. God, as you call us forth, Lord God, in a mandate, Lord God, to take our place, to do your will. Lord God, that you would reignite the flame of fire, God, that you birthed in us when we were saved. And God, that Lord, you would, Lord God, redirect our lives to do the will of God from our heart, Lord God, day by day. I thank you for the clarion call of God this morning over the church. You're calling the people to rise up as sons and daughters of God, Lord God, to push our influence into the community, into our region, Lord God, that we would declare the great works of God. And we give you all the praise in Jesus' name, and everybody said amen.
Amen.
And praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. In our context, very quickly, John 10 prison, we read that. Amen. John was the forerunner of Christ. He was in position, a great privilege. He was the one that was able to fulfill that which the prophets before him could not fill. All the prophets before John, Jesus said, prophesied of his coming. They said, Messiah is coming. One of these days, Messiah is coming. One of these days, the Christ will come, the anointed one will come, and will usher in the kingdom of God. John the Baptist, as the greatest of all the prophets born of women, stood on the shore one day in Galilee, and he saw the one that was prophesied to come, and he said, behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world. And it puts John in a privileged position that was a better position than the prophets before him. Because they prophesied he is coming. But John prophesied he has come. Yes. Hallelujah. So he was put in a position of a greater position of privilege. Amen. But Jesus qualifies that and says there's something even greater than that. Because he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. I want to talk to you and preach you for a few minutes on the thought of advancing the kingdom of God, because the kingdom of God needs to advance. Yeah. The kingdom of God is in advance, and the kingdom of God wants a call on your heart and your life to help the kingdom advance. I wish I had some help in here today. Hallelujah. When we talk about the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven, we are talking about two separate things. This is my revelation. You can take it or leave it. I believe the kingdom of heaven is a place. That Jesus declared, I go where there's a place where my Father has many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. And that is the kingdom of heaven. Say, the kingdom of heaven is a place. Amen. The kingdom of heaven is a place. Amen. Hallelujah. The kingdom of God, Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within you. The kingdom of God is principles and standards. Hallelujah. And commandments that dwell within us that begin to produce fruits of righteousness in our lives and manifest out of us to cause, hey, hallelujah, all the people around us to recognize that there's something different about you, because we take the engrafted Word of God. We take the Spirit of the living God, even that's attached to salvation, and we begin to walk in the Spirit of God, glory to God, and advance in His kingdom. Hallelujah. That's why Jesus said that the Spirit, amen, the kingdom of God is in us. Hallelujah. Amen. It produces a vital living relationship with our Savior, Jesus Christ, and we become the manifested sons and daughters of a living God. And somebody shout glory to His holy name. Amen. You become different. You are different. There's a mark upon your forehead, glory to God, that when you even walk down the streets or go and sit in Taco Bell, praise God, somebody looks at you and says, I don't know what it is about your life, but there's something different about that person. You are displaying the glory of Almighty God from the inside out. Praise the Lord. This little light of mine. Hey, it's not a little light, it's a beam of light, praise God, that begins to attract people to you so that you can attract people to God. Hallelujah. Glory to His name. Amen. And so the kingdom is advancing. Jesus came to teach us the things concerning the kingdom of God. He taught kingdom principles, kingdom standards, and kingdom commandments so we can get them on the inside, so we can get them in our spirit, so they begin to activate in our life. I want you to know the Spirit of the Lord is trying to activate and stir up the gifts of God in your life. It is a call of God to get up, child of God. Get up, sons of God. Get up, daughters of God. Shake yourself off. Praise the Lord and begin to advance the kingdom of God, because He is coming again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The kingdom culture is in a clash with the world's culture. Jesus said, you are in the world, but you are not of the world. Amen. And so we are in a kingdom clash. Amen. And the Lord is calling the church, praise the Lord, to realize that He's counting on you and counting on me to advance the kingdom of God. Amen. In this clash, in this push, when the world pushes, the church can push harder, because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. And greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. Right before this event, and Jesus begins to talk about John the Baptist and all the great work that he'd done and how he fulfilled his mandate, amen, to display the kingdom of God to his generation. He had dispersed the disciples. He had sent them out two by two, and he said, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over everything that opposes your life. And you'll find out that when you walk in God's power, when you walk in Jesus' anointing, when you walk in the life of God that's in you, greater is He that's in you than he that is in the world. That there's nothing that can move you, nothing that can shake you, nothing that can stop you, because you've got the power of God moving through your life. A devil can come your way, you can cast him out, is what Jesus told the disciples. You can speak to the mountain and be removed and have to obey you and jump into the sea, because that's what Jesus said. Praise the Lord. So there's a kingdom advancing. The
church with the kingdom of God inside them is called of God to advance the kingdom as a counterculture, not a subculture. We have to realize, praise God, that the church on the hill here is not a subculture, that we are just being absorbed into the world's culture. That's not the intention of God for our lives. God has set us apart. God has said you are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are a peculiar people. People that will show forth the praises of God. Hallelujah. You have what it takes. You are the light of the world and the salt of the earth. Praise the Lord. I wish someone would get excited right there. Glory to God. We are a counterculture. We are the ones to rise up and let people know that there is a difference maker. And his name is Jesus Christ. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And that the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is churches to prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. Jesus came once at the promise of God through John the Baptist, said, "This is the one that would come, amen, and take away the sins of the world." But Jesus went away. He died upon the cross. He went into the tomb. He rose up the third day. After a period of 40 days, he ascended to the right hand of the Father. But he said this to the church. He said, "Occupy until I come." He will change a person's life. Glory to God. He changed my life. He changed your life. And he's counting on you to tell somebody else he can change their life. He said, amen, occupy, be busy until I come, because I'm going to go away for just a little while. People say, well, a little while is a long time. It's 2,000 years and he hasn't come back yet. Maybe he's not coming. Be not discouraged. Don't slack now. Amen. Don't give up hope yet. Amen. You just don't understand the thinking and the ways of God. The Lord said, "My ways are not your ways. Neither are my thoughts your thoughts. But my thoughts and my ways are higher than yours." But there's one thing we just get all messed up and forget about. Amen. That the time of the Lord is not like our time. Amen. God's days are not like our days. He stepped into eternity. There is no time. If the Lord had a watch, he would just say now. By this one thing they were willingly ignorant of. One day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as a day. For us it's been 2,000 years, but the Lord's only been 2 days. Amen. He's telling the saints of heaven, it's almost time to go back and get the people of God. Is it already? Hallelujah. And so there is a call of God. There is a revelation that the Lord has released into the body of Christ, that we are advancing the kingdom, that God has an anointing on your life to do something. Turn to your neighbor and say, "It's time to do something." Come on, say, "It's time to do something." Glory to God. Glory to God. We can be a difference in our culture. We can be a difference in our city. We can be a difference in our region. If we'll just mention the name of Jesus, I'm telling you, something moves when you begin to declare the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Something begins to shift in the atmosphere when you begin to call the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Just the mention of his name, the Bible says the demons tremble at the sound of his name. Amen. You begin to change the atmosphere when you mention his name. Don't worry about what they say. Don't worry how they respond. Most of the time they'll be negative. Most of the time they'll be like they don't care. Most of the time it'll seem like you're not having an impact. But I heard something this week that really blessed me. And it was that, amen, the gospel seed cannot come back void. The gospel seed, praise God, does the work in people's hearts and lives. When you share the good news of Jesus Christ, it may seem like it hasn't impacted them. It may seem like it hasn't affected them. But I'm here to tell you, you have planted the seed that they can't get away from. Praise the Lord. It's beginning to do something in their life. And it takes time, but God will bring a harvest. Because whenever you plant a seed, it will bring forth fruit. Mm-hmm. Praise God. So The church needs to recognize this morning that we are positioned for privilege. Praise the Lord. Jesus had already stated that the least in the kingdom was greater than John the Baptist. That's saying a lot this morning. The advancement of the kingdom of heaven, amen, we have to understand this morning that the advancement of the kingdom of heaven is still happening today. It's not time to stop. Amen. We have to continue to have influence. I like what he says here. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. He's not talking about getting billy clubs and guns and knives and going and killing a bunch of people. He's not talking about having a revolt in the United States of America. That word there, that violent take it by force, is a word of influence. It's a word of penetration. It's a word of making yourself known and recognizable in the midst of a dark culture. It's invading their space with light. It's invading the space of darkness with light. Yeah. Hallelujah. It's really what it talks about is impressing or pressing yourself into a space, amen, and squeezing in there to let them know something. Yeah. That's what that word is talking about here. Amen. I try to pronounce the Greek, but I'm not very good at it. But you can check it out for yourselves. Amen. Write that down and see if this pastor is telling you the truth. Amen. But what he's showing us here then, that if the kingdom of heaven suffers violence and the violent take it by force, what God is truly saying there is the advancement of the kingdom of heaven requires a representation. The kingdom advance of heaven requires representation. We are ambassadors of Christ. We are the church. We are the ones that are called to represent Jesus Christ and His kingdom. What God is saying then is we have to open up our mouth and say something. Sure, they'll know that we are Christian by our love. Sure, they'll know we are Christian by our conduct. But there's no greater power than that God wants to declare today than to let you know that the greatest manifestation of the heart of God is found in someone that opens their mouth and makes a declaration. Declaration is powerful. Hallelujah. The declaration of God and His kingdom is powerful. And so the kingdom needs a representation, and that is the church. The prophets were positioned to declare that Messiah was coming. John the Baptist was positioned to declare that Christ has come. And said, behold the Lamb of God. The church is positioned to declare that victory has been won, and that Jesus lives and is coming again. No greater than the work of Jesus Christ. Raising someone from the dead is an awesome work, but it's no greater work than Jesus Christ. And that word greater does not mean in numerically, but it means positionally. It's something greater than raising the dead, opening the eyes of the blind, causing the lepers to be healed. What could be greater than that? It is the ability to offer eternal life. It's the ability to let somebody know when you receive Jesus Christ by faith, in the finished work of the cross, you will be born again. That your name can be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Amen. You will die one day, but you'll step into eternity of life with God forevermore. That was never possible until the finished work of the cross. Glory to God, we are advancing the kingdom of God with a great hope and a great truth. Amen. That we have an offer for you. Amen. That you should not refuse. And our offer is that Jesus can give you eternal life. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. We are the carriers of eternal life. We have eternal life flowing through our blood. We have eternal life flowing through our spirit. We have a hope beyond this world, praise God, that the world does not have, but the world needs. My, isn't that wonderful? Amen. The church needs to shake themselves this morning and realize that He's calling us to advance ourselves, to advance the kingdom of God, to be the representation of salt and light on this earth. that the Lord has intended for us to be. Jesus calls for this present generation to get up, get ready, and get active. Get up, get ready, and get active. I like how he goes on down there and talking about how we are to push our influence into the midst of the people that we have influence with. He tells us to squeeze into that place, to get yourself positioned to be a blessing. Get yourself positioned, amen, to share the love of God. Get yourself positioned to have an opportunity to tell somebody that Jesus is a difference maker.
Yes.
That Jesus does bring hope.
Yes.
That there is a better way of living. Get yourself positioned to find an opportunity to say something. Glory to God. Even God has called his church into a wake-up call. He said all from the prophets until the law, they prophesied until John. And if you can receive it, this was Elijah, which was for to come. We're talking about the days of Elijah, the spirit of that anointing that came upon John, that comes upon the church, that is prepares the way for the coming of the Lord. Bring the hearts of the fathers back to the children. The Lord is laying all this out before the church today. He said, this is your call. This is your call. This is your commission. This is what I want for you to do. I want you to be blessed in this life, but don't forget your highest priority. Amen. Jesus Christ, Lord of all. Praise God. Amen. So it's called the church wake-up call. And he goes down in the context and begins to say, he that has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. He says, what shall I liken to this present generation? How shall I compare you in this end days? He said, I'm going to compare you to children playing in the marketplace. What is children in the marketplace all about? It's talking about not having the spiritual intuition. Amen. You have children going into coals. What do children do? They go and they play around the racks. They get on in between the clothes. They don't know what's going on over their head. They don't realize that there's an exchange. There's something happening over their head that people are beginning to exchange things. That there's activity above them that's going on. And Jesus said, this present generation, this present church, if we are not careful, that's what we're going to do. We're not recognizing. We don't have no discernment of what God is calling, what God is saying, what God is doing. We're just busy doing what we're doing. We're kind of going between the racks and having a good time, praise the Lord. But it's not what God is calling us to. He said, let there be a spiritual discernment that God is moving in the heavenly realm, that God is pushing back on the darkness, that God is calling the church to rise up and get ready and say something. Amen. The wake-up call of the church. He's calling us to recognize that we are in a privileged position. Somebody say, praise the Lord. And God has called us to represent the Son, to represent the kingdom as sons and daughters of God. There is a call, amen, of God upon the sons and daughters. God says, in the last days, says the Lord, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, upon my sons and my daughters, upon my old men and my young men, and they shall prophesy. They shall dream dreams and have visions. And on my servants and on my handmaids in that day, what day? This day. What day? Today I will pour out my spirit, says the Lord, upon them, and they shall prophesy. God saying, get up, church. Shake yourself up. Get ready to do something. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So what is it that we need to do, Lord? What is it, God, that you're telling us this morning? The first thing he's telling us, amen, if we're here today, we need to get saved. We need to be baptized in water. We need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. We need to be saved and baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to push back, amen, on some ignorant thinking. I'm going to push back today, amen, and let you know today. You did not get the baptism of the Holy Ghost when you got saved. You didn't get the baptism of the Holy Ghost when you got saved. You got the Holy Spirit. He came connected in salvation. But you need the baptism in the Holy Ghost. If you have not been baptized in the full of the power of God, he wants to fill you up. Why? So that you can be a more effective witness for him.
Yeah.
Glory to God. Well, I don't believe in speaking in tongues. Doesn't matter. Amen. Just let God do something in your life. Present yourself, Lord. The Lord is calling for representation. Just say, Lord, here I am. I'm going to lay down every preconceived notion and idea. I know I've been taught this, I've been taught that, and people say this, and people say that, and sometimes the question, if this is of God, and that's of God, let's just kick all of that that junk out of the church right now. And let's just call the church and get up, lift up our hands and say, Lord, whatever it is you want, whatever it is you want to do in my life. God, whatever it is you call me, give me a fresh anointing. Give me a fresh power from my mind. Give me a fresh baptism in the Holy Ghost today, Lord. How long has it been since some of you have spoken in tongues? How long has it been since you've had the Spirit of God and the power that poured down on your soul? God said, amen. We were not called together with enticing words of man's wisdom. There's a lot of people that preach a lot better than I do, but I want you to know something. God didn't call us to be great preachers, great orators. God called us, amen, to present the power of God in truth. We called us all for that thing, not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in power and demonstration of the Spirit. We're not going to shake you up and knock you down. We're not going to push you over today, but I'm telling you today, there is a power from on high. There is a God in heaven that pours out the Holy Ghost, and He will pour His Spirit in your life, in His time, in His place, and in His way that will be undeniable. I know what I'm talking about this morning. He will prove Himself to you. Hallelujah. He will prove Himself to you that is real. All you've got to do is present yourself. Lay down your preconceived notions and ideas and just say, yes, Lord. I wonder how many would lift their hands today to God and say, yes, Lord. Your will be done. Amen. To advance the kingdom of God, we need salvations. We need people filled with the Holy Ghost. We need people, praise the Lord, that are baptized in water with all these experiences. Why? Because I'm telling you why. Because people with an experience are never at a disadvantage to those with an argument. Say that again. People with an experience are never at a disadvantage to those with an argument. People will debate you and say, I don't believe that word. I don't know if that's true. I don't know about this. I don't know about that. And you can say, it's too late to tell you that. I'm telling you what I know. I'm telling you what I've experienced. I've been there. I've experienced. I've been to the water. I've been baptized. I've been to the altar. I've been saved. My life has changed. I'm no longer the same. Amen. Because that word is true. He created me a new heart. He gave me a new soul. He pulled my feet out of miry clay. And He set my feet on the rock. And fill the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You want a church revived, you want a church on fire, then you start sharing your faith. You start telling people about Jesus. You watch what happens. People begin to be interested in what you have to say if your life matches, if your talk matches your walk. I'll just leave that word out here this morning. Amen. Amen. Maybe I should question and say, Lord, does my talk match my walk? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Someone said the church is full of hypocrites. That might be true. We're not all hypocrites, but there's probably some in the church. We need to look at ourselves, though. Don't look around, rubbernecking with somebody else. Look at yourself and ask the question, am I one? That's what God would have us do, work out our own salvation in fear and trembling. Look at my own heart and say, am I living the life of a hypocrite? Or am I letting God have His will in my life? I'm not calling you to perfection. I'm calling you, amen, to repentance. The glory of God. I feel the Holy Ghost on that one. Hallelujah. That's right. That's right. I don't do everything right, but thank God His grace has me covered. And when I make a mistake, I can just go to the altar. God, I repent of what I said. God, I repent of how I thought. God, I repent of anything that I did in my life that did not please You. That keeps me right standing with God. That keeps me clean before the Lord. That keeps me confidence and boldness and knowing that I can go tell somebody that Jesus can save your soul, that Jesus can fill you with the Holy Ghost, that Jesus will baptize you in water and you'll come up, praise God, out of that place a different person. Yeah. Ooh, glory to God. Someone's going to say hallelujah. Oh, you don't look at me so funny. You guys, I saw you. You came up out of that tub just... our joy of salvation. So we need to get people saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Baptized in water. We need to get God's Word into our spirit. Your spiritual battles will be won by declaring the Word of God over your situation. Hallelujah. Peter said, let the Word of God richly dwell within you. You need to read your Bibles. You you need to memorize scriptures. You need to have those things in your soul, because when the times of attack come and they do come, you can rise up in faith. You can rise up in power. You can rise up declaring the word of God over your situation, over your house, over your business, over your church, over your community, and you can begin to declare what God has said. Amen. And if God said it, amen, there is no fighting it. God will perform His word. Amen. As you begin to declare the word of God, this is the thing we do to advance the kingdom of heaven. We get saved and baptized, filled the Holy Ghost, baptized in water, getting the word of God in our spirit, having a devotion life flowing through our life, and that word will be there in times of need. Hallelujah. In a time when you got laid off prematurely and you don't know where the money is going to come from and the bills keep coming in, you can stand up and declare the word of God that says, "But my God shall supply all of my need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus." And you declare the word of God, and when you speak a word of God, amen, it has power. It begins to move the atmosphere. It begins to change situations. We've tried this in our home over and over through the years, and we found out that God is faithful to keep His word. Number three, you need to listen for God's voice. Amen. God has direction for your life. He speaks by His word. He speaks through prophetic release, and He speaks by the still, small voice. Amen. We need to listen. We need to get to a quiet place. And God, what is it that you're trying to say? What is it? How is it that you're trying to direct my life? We need to acknowledge His presence and direction for our life. We need to acknowledge His presence and direction for our life on a daily basis. Give us this day our daily bread. Hallelujah. Jesus, being our example, said, "You got alone with the Father, Lord, what is it you want me to do? What's your direction for my life for today?" He got up from that place of secret prayer, and He began to declare, "I will do what the Father tells me to do. And I only say what the Father tells me to say." What are you saying? I'm saying God has you positioned strategically today to advance the kingdom of God. And those things He did for the prophets of old, the things He did for John the Baptist, are the things He will do for the church of the living God. He will anoint your life in a way, in a measure, praise God, and you will have impact. You will make a difference in other people's lives. You can turn people's lives around. You can turn the community around as you acknowledge the presence of God and realize you're not doing it by yourself. You're empowered. Amen. You're equipped by the anointing power of Almighty God. Hallelujah. It's time to advance the kingdom of God. Amen. To get up and shake off the lethargy and say, "Amen, I don't want to be like those children playing around in the rats, not recognizing God is doing something great, and God is doing something great." Hallelujah. Amen. Being sensitive, amen, to in that quiet time of knowing God's voice, so that we can take pause in our day and recognize the Lord saying, "Hey, go talk to that person. Tell them." Sometimes just real quiet. The opportunity presents itself. And someone on the job, tell them. Amen. Hallelujah. For the story about this one guy that was training this other man. He was telling him about his relationship with Jesus Christ. And the guy said, "I don't want to hear it. It's happened the last couple of weeks. I don't want to hear it. I grew up in church. I got my parents. I got people. I've been to church. I know all about it. Tired of it. Don't hear it." "Oh, that's fine. That's fine." But he has his tape playing. He has his light shining. It's his light. I said he has his light shining. And he prays in front of this guy. He tells him his testimony of what Jesus did for him. In the process of a couple of weeks, this man's heart begins to turn. He begins to ask the question. He calls him up and says, "Hey, I've got a serious situation in my family. Would you pray for my need?" "What are you saying?" "I'm saying when we enter into the opportunity, when we are close enough to God and realize that God has a mandate on our life, He's called His church to advance the kingdom. And we take opportunity because of the sensitiveness of recognizing the atmosphere which we're in. That we're not playing among the racks and hide ourselves in the clothes. But we're out in the open and we recognize the atmosphere of opportunity for exchange. Then we seize the moment and we say something. And we may not get immediate response, but we might. Then we seize the moment of opportunity in the opportunity of the moment. And that's what God called us to rise up as the children of God. Day is getting short. Jesus was sitting there on a bench waiting for the disciples to come back. And a woman comes, needing water, the woman at the well. He begins to engage her in conversation in a natural way, talking about natural water. Can you give me a drink? Not that you guys know the story, how the story goes, but the Lord opens it up into a spiritual realm. And that's what God is calling His church to do. Take an opportunity to meet people just where they're at. Don't be so spiritually minded and so up here, self-righteous, that people are turned off by you. Let's get real. We all sin and come short of the glory of God, but God is looking for real people. The millennials, that distinguishes them more than anything else in their generation, they're looking for the real. They want people to be real. And when we are real, people begin to gravitate and recognize you're real, and they'll take notice. Jesus was just real with her and began to open up to her spiritual things. And began to share with her the need of living water. And on that day, she received the Lord in a very special way. And she ran into her city. She told everybody, come and see a man. Come and see a man that told me everything I've ever done. This is not indeed the Christ. You never know what your testimony is going to do. Your time of opportunity is just to be real with somebody and share with them the goodness of God. You don't have to know the Bible from cover to cover. All you need to know is what Jesus has done for your life. All you need to do is share the opportunity of your testimony. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. I know where I've come from, and I know where I would be if it wasn't for the grace of God. For the love of God poured out in my life, I wouldn't be here today. But thank God, His mercy and grace found me. Mercy saved my life. He reached out in the nick of time. And your testimony is valuable. Hallelujah. It's time to advance the kingdom. Take your moment of opportunity. Recognize what God is doing in the atmosphere. Seize the hold of your moment. And tell somebody there's a better way of living. Would you stand your feet with me all around the church? From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Moving into that space, moving into that spot of letting our influence mean something to somebody that needs it. That's what God's calling us to today. That's how we advance the kingdom of God, one soul at a time, moving to that place of opportunity and sharing what Jesus did for me. As you're standing all around this church together, I just want to very quickly tell you today that God loves you. That Jesus died for each and every one of us the same way. When He died upon the cross and said, "It is finished," He saw your face as well as mine, and He loves you today. Jesus died on the cross and rose for eternal life for each and every one of us. And if you're today, you have not a Bible living relationship with God, you've never confessed Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, today is your day of opportunity to do that. You can make that real in your soul now. And as all around this church people are standing, if that's you today, and you know that you've never confessed Jesus Christ with your mouth, you never asked Him to come into your heart and forgive you from your sins, then now's your opportunity. Just lift your hands and say, "Pastor, that's me. Pray for me." Is there one today that would lift their hands and say, "I've never received Jesus as my Savior. Pray for me." Are you here today? You're here this morning. God has spoken. The Lord is stirring you to be a witness for Him, to advance the kingdom of God. It's been a long time since you felt your soul stir to really involve yourself. Push yourself in violently or strategically or purposely. Push your influence into a situation, into a conversation. You haven't done that in a long, long time. And you know that God is stirring your soul today. And you want to commit yourself to be one of that people that will make an impact into those people that God gives you. Would you raise your hand all around the church? Amen. We're going to pray a prayer. We're going to close in worship. As hands are raised all around this church,
Lord, as you have spoken from on high by your word, and through the anointing that's been released, God, give us ears to hear and a heart to respond and say, yes, Lord, here I am. Use me. Lord, use my life. Anoint me in a fresh way that I will step in, Lord God, to the community, into my places of influence, recognizing, Lord, the moving of the atmosphere of an opportunity to make my influence known and tell people about you. The seed of the gospel will not be turned away. They may not acknowledge it. They may even say, leave me alone. I don't want to hear it. But as you are faithful to deliver the seed of the word of God, it will have impact. They will never forget your influence as you advance the kingdom into their heart and told them that Jesus loves them. God, we seal this today in the power of the Holy Spirit. You've deposited faith in our heart, in our soul. You've deposited, Lord God, a fresh equipping and unction to go out and advance the kingdom. Now as we leave this place, Lord, let your hand be heavy on us to recognize our opportunity and be faithful, Lord. As John the Baptist was faithful in his mandate and said, behold him, Lord, let us say, behold him. God bless you. We thank you for being a part of this service today. I know the word had impact in your life, and God is going to use you for his glory. Go in the favor and the power of God. In Jesus' name.